We're now moving right into an opportunity to have a regional perspective on the Indo-Pacific. As indicated earlier, these constructs don't exist independently from their regions. As Australia adopts a more expansive view of its region, the Indo-Pacific, it's important to understand the different policies and priorities and perspectives from our partners in the region, the Indo-Pacific. And to lead this discussion, we're honored to have former Minister of Defense and also former Minister of Foreign Affairs, the Honorable Stephen Smith, who also serves as a professor at the UWA Law School and is chairman of the UWA Public Policy Board of Advisors, to lead a discussion. We've got tremendous panelists from, as indicated, from Korea, from India, from Japan, from the United States, but I'll turn that over to Professor Smith to lead that discussion. So, Stephen.
Well, thanks very much, Gordon. It sounds as though I'm wired up and loud, so first technical problem overcome. We've had an Australian view, in a sense, so far this morning. The Governor, the Premier, the Minister for Defence, and also from Rory Medcalf with the academic and theoretical underpinning of the Australian view of the Indo-Pacific. Our first panel, we now have a very distinguished international panel putting a regional perspective. We firstly have Shivshankar Menon, a distinguished fellow from Brookings, India. We're very pleased to see you here. Most of us get to see you in Delhi, so welcome to Perth. And Shivshankar Menon is, of course, a former National Security Advisor for India and head of the Indian Foreign Ministry as Foreign Secretary, and also previously Ambassador for India to Pakistan and to China. Sheila Smith is a Senior Fellow from the Council of Foreign Relations, a regular visitor to Australia, author, Japanese and North Asia expert. Sheila, great to see you, again. Professor Noboru Yamaguchi from the International University of Japan. Professor, great to see you again. Professor, in a former life, of course, was a general in the Japanese Self-Defense Force and commander of land forces. So, General, great to see you again. Welcome to Perth. And finally, from the Republic of Korea, Ambassador Taeyong Cho, who is a former senior advisor in the Blue House, a former senior Republic of Korea member of the Six-Party Talks delegation, but most well known in Australia and Perth as a former Korean ambassador to Australia. So, Ambassador, welcome. All of our panelists will have a short 5 to 7 minutes to make some introductory remarks, and then we'll have a panel discussion. I'm under strict military instructions to not go over 40 minutes, so that'll see you lose, on my calculation, 7 minutes of morning tea. For that, you can variously blame the Governor, the Premier, Rory Medcalf, or the Minister, entirely a matter of the exercise of your discretion, but we will get you to morning tea with plenty of time for refreshments. So, Shivshankar Menon, we've had, as I say, the Australian view. How does India see the strategic notion of the Indo-Pacific, and what implications does that have for security in our region? And of course, you're not restricted to answering that question. These are your own opening remarks.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Stephen, and thank you for having me. It's good of you to ask me to come here. You know, you said we just heard an Australian point of view, but quite frankly, listening to that, I felt I was home. Because there wasn't that much difference in the way Indians now look at the concept of the Indo-Pacific. There's a huge coincidence of interest there, the reasons why it's important to us. I think very few Indians themselves realize that almost half our GDP today is external merchandise trade, that we depend on the Indo-Pacific and freedom of navigation and in these waters. And all the reasons that were mentioned for the importance of the Indo-Pacific, you know, the economic reasons, etc. Where there's maybe a slight difference in approach, and this is something which may explain why there seems to be an impression that India is hesitant about the concept, is because if you look at India's geographic position, we're both a continental and a maritime power. And for us, to only look at the maritime order across maritime Asia is not sufficient solution. It's a huge part of our security outlook, but it's not enough. We have to worry about the continental order as well. The other reason is because if you look at the three water bodies that we're talking about. The Indian Ocean is an open geography. It's an area which, therefore, has very seldom been a battle space in history. The seas near China are closed geographies, and like other closed geographies, the Mediterranean and so on, it's a natural battle space. It's an area that people contend over. The Western Pacific is fundamentally a U.S. lake, and looks like it's going to stay that way for some time. So if you look at the balance of forces in these three bodies of water, the security problems in these waters, there is a commonality in terms of security of sea lanes and maritime traffic, but there is a difference in the way we can deal with it. And so that's really where, if there is a difference or hesitation, that's really where it comes from. But basically, I think you'll find that much of what was said today could be said by an Indian premier and was probably said by Prime Minister Modi at the Shangri-La Dialogue in Singapore in July. He, of course, has the broadest definition of the Indo-Pacific. He talks of the east coast of Africa to the west coast of America, unlike Secretary Mattis, who I think speaks of Bollywood to Hollywood. So for us, therefore, the Indo-Pacific is very important. We are making major investments in both capability, but more important in the way we think about the Indo-Pacific. And most important, as was mentioned earlier, the environment in which we are dealing with maritime security and other issues in this region has changed so dramatically in the last few years. I think there's no question that we are in a situation of much more intense competition between the great powers, of contention. We're in a very peculiar situation. The two strongest powers in the Indo-Pacific, Maritime Asia, whatever you want to call it, are today revisionist powers. And that is unprecedented. I don't think any of us can remember a situation like that. Today, if you look at this entire region from our point of view, most of the new security agenda that we face, which includes freedom of navigation, includes cybersecurity, includes things like terrorism, all these are not issues which recognize any boundaries or even the distinction between maritime continental orders. And we need to actually find a way of dealing with this. How do we deal with it? As an Indian, I don't think this might look like 19th century Europe, different powers of different capabilities contending, yes, but I don't think you're going to get a Concert of Europe moment or a Helsinki moment or a top-down solution. I'm not sure that East Asia Summit or any of these, this alphabet soup of organizations we have is ready to step into that. I really think we need to build it from the bottom up, bit by bit, pick each bit, open the door to the negotiating room to anybody who's interested. Say we want to deal with freedom of navigation in the area, separated from the sovereignty issues, and you have some hope of dealing with it, cyber as well. But this is true of the whole list of issues that we face across the region, and build it up. And I really think there is still enough common interest among the powers, and especially if powers like Australia, India, Japan step forward. I think Prime Minister Abe was probably visionary in seeing this first among the leaders or saying so. And I really think if we do that and involve everybody in between, I mean the Indonesians, the ASEAN and so on feel left out by this idea of the Quad that somehow we've ascribed special status to ourselves. But I think we need to involve them all, and that's why I say an open, inclusive process. One last point. We keep talking of stability. Forget stability. There's no such thing as stability in a region where the balance of power is shifting so quickly, economics, every which way, security. And when you say stability to people like, to rising powers, it sounds like you're saying, stay where you are. Remain as, what is it? Hewers of wood and drawers of water. That's not what, so talk of predictability. That makes sense. I mean, talk of a system which accommodates everybody and work on the Venn diagram where our common interests coincide. That would be my advice.
That's terrific. Thanks very much. Sheila, a US view, if I could say so. And
It's a great pleasure to be back in Perth, and thank you, and congratulations to the USAsia Centre and to Western Australia for this wonderful event. I get to represent your distant ally in North America, somewhat distracted, as Rory said, or revisionist, even, as Professor Menon suggested. We are at a difficult moment in the United States. You watch it from far away. I watch it very close up in Washington, and it makes me somewhat concerned about our ability to play the strategic role that I think we ought to be playing today in the region. Nonetheless, I think we have some signals of where the Trump administration wants to go on the Indo-Pacific, and I thought I'd share some of those thoughts with you. There's a series of speeches we could trace. I think the most relevant of those, of course, has been both Secretary Mattis's address at the Shangri-La Dialogue and the more recent speech by Secretary of State Mike Pompeo on the economic dimensions of our Indo-Pacific engagement. But I think we also, politics aside, we have to understand that the U.S. policy does have very strong elements of continuity. We have deep and enduring interests in the Asia-Pacific, the Indo-Pacific. I don't think you're going to see us shift on a dime. However, the rhetoric and the debates in the United States, you should take as serious debates over Americans' desire and willingness to play a leading role in this process. So I second the recommendation that this is a time for Australia, for Japan, for South Korea, for our allies in the region to step forward to help the United States in this conversation about its role. Let me just say one very obvious point, and it's worth repeating, is that American investment in hard power in the region, of course, continues. And this administration, the Trump administration, has just approved a significant increase in its military budget for the fiscal 2019 year. We will be spending $82 billion more next year on military capability than we spent this year. It's important also, the nomenclature, of course, of our combined command in Hawaii has changed. We are now the Indo-Asia-Pacific Command. That is the largest of our six combined commands. Our military is very forward-leaning in the region, as you know. So despite the rhetoric and the diplomatic kind of pushing and pulling, I think you should be assured that this is not a region that the United States is going to give up on very easily. I worry just a little bit about our ability to implement a diplomatic strategy in addition to our military strategy. I think that's where Secretary Pompeo's speech to me was a positive sign. He began to speak in the language that Australians and Japanese and others speak of, to talk about connectivity, to talk about American investment in the region, to talk about energy, infrastructure, and the digital economy that the United States needs to be engaged in order to continue to play a vital role here. The resources that we need to bring to bear to that program are not yet where I would like to see it be, but I think it's a good start in the right direction to bring our economic engagement back up into focus. Let me say a couple things about our relationship with China. I don't think we can think about our Indo-Pacific strategy without thinking about the future of the US-PRC relationship. Vice President Pence gave a speech a few weeks back at the Hudson Institute. He will be here next month representing the United States at the East Asia Summit and at APEC, so we should pay attention to the focal point that he has on China-US relations as now being competitive and indeed somewhat much more challenging than in the past. The National Security Strategy, of course, has already identified China as a revisionist power, and Secretary Mattis has articulated that. But what I worry a little bit about is the combination of our confrontation with China over economic practices, which I think are real, and I think that conversation and negotiation is necessary, but combined with this newer, harder line coming out of the Trump administration, I worry just a little bit that we are watching our able to move our way forward to a much more constructive relationship with China rather than taking China head on in a way that I think could end up exacerbating the strategic competition and conflict that we were discussing earlier. I do think, though, that there is another element to it. We have an election next week. Vice President Pence's comments about the Chinese role in our domestic politics, of course, raised sensitivities among the American people. And once we get to the other side of that, hopefully that piece of the puzzle might recede somewhat. So what does this all mean? I think if you are sitting out here in the region, despite the rhetoric and the disruptive notion of America's future engagement in the region, that you should focus largely on the continuity of our engagement. I don't think that this is a moment where the United States is going to retreat completely from its role here in Asia or its role globally. However, you may find that the balance of instruments that the United States wants to bring to bear on its own interests may favor the hard power capabilities that I mentioned earlier. I think our alliances have a very strong role to play in shaping our diplomatic strategy in the region, and I invite you to continue to share with us your sense of how the United States can best move forward to continue to engage constructively in building the kind of collective action and networks of cooperation that I think are so vital, not only to my country, but obviously to this region as well. So let me stop there, Stephen. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sheila. General Yamaguchi,
thank you very much,
from Japan.
Thank you very much for inviting me here to this wonderful, beautiful place of Perth. This is my first time to be here, and I am supposed to use a map. That's it. As I am an ex-army officer, without map, I cannot even go across the road. And this is a map, but I found this is kind of a Sino-centric version of Indo-Pacific area. But I would use this to speak about a little bit more tactical details later. Asia-Pacific or Indo-Pacific or even the Belt and Road, whatever we call, the area has been and will be a center of gravity, as Professor Rory Metcalf mentioned before, for both economic and political terms. And the point was clearly noted by Secretary, it's not new, Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, when she wrote an essay in Foreign Policy in November 2011, entitled America's Pacific Century, arguing that area from the Pacific Ocean to the Indian Ocean has become a key driver of global politics, and the United States should keep involved in the region to stand at this central point of the world's politics. This is true now. America's Indo-Pacific vision, China's BRI, and Japan's arc of freedom and prosperity, proposed by then Foreign Minister Aso, now Deputy Prime Minister, all aim at overlapping geographic areas where the future of growth of the world economy will heavily depend on. It is also noted that the similar era from the Korean Peninsula to the home of America was once described as arc of instability in the Quadrennial Defense Review 2001. In short, this area contains both huge opportunities for the future of the world and the serious challenges to overcome. From a Japanese point of view, its lifelines run through the East China Sea, the South China Sea. Lifeline goes to East China Sea, South China Sea, the Malaccan Strait, Indian Ocean to the Gulf and the East Coast of Africa. To me, this vast maritime area consists of several sub-regions whose geostrategic implications differ from one to another, with different actors, with different roles to play, and varied strengths of influence to exercise. One, the East China Sea is a maritime and area where Japan, along with the US Navy and Air Force, enjoy the robust defense capabilities of us. Japan and China, with their Coast Guard and navies are making every effort to avoid any accidental escalation of tension between the two islands around the Senkaku. Any escalation could easily frame people's sentiment both in Tokyo and Beijing towards higher level of confrontation. The South China Sea, while U.S. naval and air power is and will be dominant, China's capability have grown and become far more powerful than the other regional actors, such as ASEAN countries, while still far to reach the United States. Japan needs to work together with coastal countries such as other member states, as well as the U.S. and other countries that respect the rule-based international order to keep the South China Sea open and safe. Good news is that more and more actors are becoming interested in respecting a rule-based order in this region and involved in actions to preserve it. In addition to U.S. Freedom of Navigation operations, U.S. allies and partners such as the United Kingdom, France, Australia, sharing the same idea by sending naval vessels to South China Sea and Western Pacific. India's Act East policy has let it send its fleet to this region regularly in the last several years, since 2012. Japan's efforts to build capacity in Asia, ASEAN member states for maritime security are an example of a new type of regional cooperation. Beyond the Malacca Strait, Japan needs to cooperate with India and Australia, who have strong geopolitical influence there, along with the US, the only country in the world that has continuous global reach by air and naval forces. India and Australia can play a great role for security of the Indian Ocean. For example, medium range surface-to-surface missile of India may have a vast area of around the coastal area within the range of their missiles. And also, as the Air Chief of India declared, the Air Force, one of the most important Air Force mission is to provide air superiority from Malacca Strait to the Gulf. And the China is located in the center. That is important. And China can play a crucial role for regional security in either positive or negative direction. As sub-regions has different geographic characteristics with varying influence of major actors, no country, including China, can be totally dominant. While China is in the key position, strategic calculation on how much influence it can exercise is extremely complicated, depending upon where and against whom. And I will stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, General. Ambassador, a Korean view.
I'm very pleased to be back in Perth. When I was Korean ambassador in Canberra to the Commonwealth, actually I thought that other than Canberra, the greatest time I spent in all the cities of Australia was actually Perth. So I've been to Perth, thank you. I've been to Perth, I think about 10 times in the span of 18 months during which I was ambassador in Canberra. So I know this is a very important city, and this is where also I first heard the word Indo-Pacific rather than Asia-Pacific. Well, unfortunately, for many Koreans, the term Indo-Pacific came to them when the U.S. Asia-Pacific Command renamed itself as Indo-Pacific Command. But for some who follow national security issues in my country, Indo-Pacific concept came much earlier. Well, Korea is a country always trying to punch above its weight, like Australia. So our two countries, back in 1989, joined our hands and proposed the concept of a Asia-Pacific. Well, now we have many regional dialogues, but at the time, Asia-Pacific is the first one and the only one when we embraced US, China, and Japan, and all other countries, so that our leaders meet once a year and talk about all things for leaders believe fit to talk about. Now, the Korea, while trying to punch above its weight, is always hampered by immediate security problems. That's North Korea. I think some of you might remember that when North Korea actually displayed a map for which they are going to use for a long-range missile test several years ago, And this map, actually, Australia was kind of at the center and in the direction that North Korean missiles is going to fly into. So that really grabbed the attention of many, not only in Australia, but also in the Philippines and other countries. That also says that actually the national security of my country and Northeast Asia is rather closely connected to the national security of this region. So our hands are usually tied with North Korean problems. Like now, a North Korean nuclear problem is getting more threatening, so my country, in cooperation with other countries, are trying to solve these problems. So while Republic of Korea is trying to propose a policy, trying to execute a policy directed towards a Southeast Asia, Indo-Pacific region, in successive presidencies, we announce the policies, and usually we don't have enough time to really follow up on that, unfortunately. So this government of President Moon Jae-in, announced that they are going to pursue new southern policies, focusing on our cooperation with India, ASEAN countries, and above all, Australia. But this focus is usually economic rather than national security because, as I said, our security is so preoccupied with North Korean challenges. But I think my country has to grow up and has to go beyond only a predominantly economic focus when it comes to Indo-Pacific because, first of all, we are 100% dependent upon outside energy supply, and over 90% of our oil supply and virtually 100% of our gas supply come through Indo-Pacific region. So these sea lanes are actually vital to Korea's economic and national security interests. So one day, Korea will have to realize the potential to become a more active player in this part of the world. And having said that, actually, Australia is playing a role and is going to play a role to awaken this need and this consciousness that has to be awakened in my country. Actually, following the United States, Australia is the second country with which Korea is conducting a 2+2 ministerial meeting. That means foreign affairs minister and defense minister. And Australia, other than United States, is the only country with which our militaries, all three military divisions, the Army, Air Force, and the Navy, are having prospering cooperative relations. So much so that actually the Korea and Australia several years back was cooperating in terms of training their personnel to new a surveillance aircraft we bought from the United States because actually our militaries, when it comes to military armaments and their viewpoints and the way they are trained are actually mutually complementary. And I believe that this already important military-to-military cooperation will be a conducive my country awakening to the needs to realize our potential to be more active in this part of the world. Thank you, I'll stop here.
Well, we've got between 10 and 15 minutes for a panel discussion, so I'll come to the more general question about what can we all do to address the security and strategic challenges, but I'm just going to take the opportunity just a couple of sort of country-based questions. So, Ambassador, I'll, without notice, start with you. If you look at key countries in the region, Australia, India, US, Japan, Indonesia, the largest ASEAN economy, all of the leaders of those countries have all, in recent times, put out an Indo-Pacific mantra. They've sort of nailed the mast to the Indo-Pacific. You've made the point that we haven't seen this from Korea, understandably, because the daily life of a South Korean president and cabinet is the Korean Peninsula and North Korea. But I take it from your remarks that you would welcome, at some stage, Korea nailing its mast to the Indo-Pacific as a notion, a strategic notion, not just the Asia-Pacific, And when do you think we might see such a statement from the South Korean administration?
Well, as a matter of fact, it was President Trump who explained the concept of Indo-Pacific to my president, I think it's last year. And the discussions, as I see it, was inconclusive in the sense that President Trump tried to explain the concept to us, and President Moon said, we are going to study it, we are going to come up with our official responses to that. And following on that, actually, in August this year, our foreign ministry and U.S. State Department held a working level discussions to come up with a common responses. And I'm sure that we are going to do that pretty soon. As the outcome of the August discussions, they agreed that Indo-Pacific is important, and they agreed that Indo-Pacific be open and transparent and the embracing, inclusive rather than exclusive. And in addition to that, actually recently my president visited India. And naturally Indian press posed the questions about what's the Korean perspectives of Indo-Pacific. And my president said that Indo-Pacific is important. Korea is in the region, but at the same time, not that in so many words, but President Moon actually focused upon the economic importance of Indo-Pacific to Korea. He didn't go far as to really elaborate our viewpoints about the security aspect of the Indo-Pacific. That, I think, should come later.
Thank you. Shivshankar, Menon and General Yamaguchi, Prime Minister Modi has gone to the Shangri-La dialogue, gone to Jakarta and waxed lyrical about the Indo-Pacific. Prime Minister Abe has been a strong supporter of the notion for over a decade in two terms of government. Overnight, we saw Prime Minister Modi being hosted at the private residence of Prime Minister Abe, and the announcement overnight of a 2+2 foreign and defence ministers, India and Japan. And the ambassador mentioned the 2+2 that Australia has with Korea, which we have with the United States and also Japan. How significant do the two of you see that 2+2 development? If you proceed on the basis that you can't have the Indo-Pacific without India and a lesser extent Indonesia, does the 2+2 really consolidate sort of the growing, inverted commas, Indo-Pacific architecture?
India-Japan cooperation is one of the key factors for a big picture. But when Prime Minister Modi came to Japan for his first time in official position, he said, "We are waiting you with red carpet, not red tapes." And I know Japanese bureaucracy is notorious. But
we can learn from each other.
Same kind of, India, Japan, in terms of implementing policy at the working level, is not easy, but steadily going ahead, and we share the sort of common kind of value, Hinduism, Buddhism, sort of common understanding of the cosmos. Help us promote understanding. And now we are doing a better job than before. The 2012 first ever fleet visited Yokosuka, and the first ever India-Japan naval exercise was held. Since then, it has become sort of regular thing. Everybody sees the Indian Navy in the Western Pacific, in South China Sea. And also, we are considering more concrete agreement on more close cooperation. For instance, in international missions like UN peacekeeping operation, we should have a sort of agreement for what we call ACSA kind of agreement too. So our cooperation should and is becoming. More workable.
Shivshankar?
My answer would be much the same, that we're actually, for me, the more important thing is what we actually do together in practice. And we're now looking at, mutual logistics support, We're looking at working together on connectivity across the entire region, with Africa as well, but in the region as well, east-west connectivity especially. And so, for me, that's the important part. I think the 2+2 is really a symbol of the government's determination and to carry this through. We might have been, I mean, we signed our first defense agreement between India and Japan in 2005, and it's grown since then. We're also looking at what else we can do in terms of defense production, in terms of on the hardware and the technology side. I think there's a whole host of areas where we can work together. And it's been led by the navies, actually, on both sides. And I think that's quite a remarkable development. Both our systems are getting used to this, to the idea that the navies can actually lead policy and lead government to policy outcomes, which it's been a learning process, which explains why, you know, it's taken some time. But for me, this is solid. It's going to grow, and it has a tremendous future.
Sheila, you're a Japan expert. The first 2+2 was the US-Japan 2+2, which has been very important, and we share a trilateral dialogue with that 2+2. How do you see the significance of the Japan-India 2+2?
So I think it just does exactly what Noboru and Shivshankar said, is it elevates the commitment of the governments to continue to produce the agenda of cooperation. I mean, 2+2s are places where you get both diplomatic and military conversations moving forward in a strategic pathway that then the bureaucracies in the navies and everybody follow through on. So I think it's very important. I think what I thought was interesting about last weekend's diplomacy, not just the Modi visit to Japan, was that it came on the heels of Mr. Abe's visit to Beijing. And I think that's the kind of symmetry in diplomacy that you were seeing in the region today that I think is critical, that we don't see the Indo-Pacific concept or strategy as exclusionary, that it's inclusionary, and that we persuade the Beijing that there's a lot of ways in which we can engage, move forward for the benefit of the region. And I think that's one of the pieces of the Modi-Abe dialogue. Also, it's very critical.
Well, Sheila, that's a terrific segue into where the rubber hits the road. So what can we all do in the region? Now, Shivshankar, I thought you made a really telling point, which is there's no point talking about stability. The whole world's changing around us. The rise of China, the ongoing importance of the US, the rise of India as a great power, the emergence of Indonesia by 2050 as the fourth largest economy in the world. So we all knew that the world was changing. And you ladle over the top of that uncertainty in terms of policy direction from the United States, but also growing Chinese assertiveness, the Deng Xiaoping consensus over potentially the responsible stakeholder is over. So you overlay a changing geopolitical world with uncertainty from China and the US, the current, inverted commas, T2 or Big 2. So, and General Yamaguchi's slide showed your point that India is a continental power with the territorial disputes with China, but then the potential flashpoints, East China Sea, South China Sea, Malacca Straits, and the Indian Ocean writ large. So, What can all of us do to make sure that in a changing world, we have your predictability, where we don't have uncertainty, which can lead to misjudgment, miscalculation, and conflict? How do we keep the old word stability into the new world of predictability?
You're
first.
Well, I wish I knew. No, the fact
and
is that...
Ignore the ringing bell. We've got a few minutes yet.
I think there's three parts to this. One is, yes, the US and China have shown dissatisfaction with the present state of affairs. That doesn't mean they and the rest of us cannot agree on a better state of affairs, on a better condition. And that's why I say it has to be open and inclusive. If we say it's open, you need to actually include everybody, including China. As long as China sees this as anti-Chinese, it's going to be difficult. Frankly, I'm maybe a little more pessimistic today than I was a year ago, because I'm not sure that you can reset the China-US economic relationship without affecting their strategic planning and the way they deal with the rest of the region. And I was in Beijing last week, and I've never seen So many people so worried about that relationship or the region. You know, 1996, Taiwan States crisis. Two US aircraft carriers, and China felt humiliated in her backyard. And if you look at everything since then, South China Sea, Taiwan, et cetera, it guarantees that she will never face the same situation again. My fear is that tariffs and whatever will lead to a similar kind of conclusion, that we have to make sure that in 12 years from now, we never face the same, that we're not hostage to the rest of the world. And for the first time, you're seeing both China and the US exclusionary. The new NAFTA says no agreements with non-market economies. China and the South China Sea Code draft that she's produced says you won't do military exercises with anybody else without consensus among all the parties. In other words, China has a veto. Now, once you start breaking that Indo-Pacific, Asia-Pacific, whatever you want to call it, down into exclusive zones and becomes either you're with us or against us, then we're in real trouble. And that's where I think there's a role for the rest of us to stress that you can't deal with our security like this. I mean, there's no going back to a version, a sort of Asian version of the Cold War. And I think there is a role for all of us to try and set, and for me that is critical. If we can handle that part and stress the common interests, and then I think we have a way forward. But this is a PhD thesis you want. At least. Yeah.
Well, Sheila, in 60 seconds, the answer to the PhD thesis.
The answer to the PhD thesis. So I can't honestly say that I can predict for you here the outcome of the tariff war between the China and the United States. What I do worry about, and what I picked up on Vice President Pence's speech, is a little bit that it makes China into the bad guy in every dimension of interaction with the United States. And I'm hopeful that when the Vice President comes here next month, that he will, A, listen to everybody here in the region, explain why we need to figure out a different way forward. I do suspect that there is some tempering that can be done, and with a strong advocacy of India, Australia, Japan, and South Korea, that we build an Asia-Pacific together that allows China to find its place in the same way. But I don't think I'm very sanguine at the moment, I don't want to end on a pessimistic note or not answer the larger question, that we are going to see a US-China relationship that's going to steady or stabilize anytime soon. And so one of the pieces of the puzzle that I would say would invert Asia-Pacific regionalism is it used to be we were part of the solution. And I think what needs to be recognized is there's a very active role now in persuasion vis-a-vis Washington about the costs and the risks, not only to the region, but also to the United States, of continuing to pursue a confrontational approach. So I don't have an answer. I think it'll take time. It's not going to be decided by the end of this year. We're going to watch two or three American administrations, I think, play out this rebalancing of the US-PRC relationship. It's not simply about this president and this administration. This is a larger challenge, I think, for the United States, and it will need all of you to help us on the way through.
General?
Yeah. I am not too pessimistic. And from the Japanese selfish point of view, freedom of navigation in South China Sea is a key. Safety of navigation there is a key. In the perfect world, ideal case, China is participating in slow sea lines of communication protection. And Beijing blames Tokyo as a free rider. You have to do more. That is ideal. And the worst case is something bloody happens, and China has really serious problem of keeping their lines of communication while Japan is doing the same thing. But something in between will be the reality. And it is not impossible. As I mentioned before, there are a number of different factors. So while we may not be able to find the best solution, but it is rather easy to find a solution to make a stalemate.
Ambassador, final word.
Well, working as a diplomat for almost 40 years, I used to say that the diplomats are paid to be optimistic. So I should be optimistic, but really, I mean, more seriously, from Korea, the competition between US and China is much more strategic than just economic competition or competition in the realms of South China Sea, because Republic of Korea has a national goal, unchanging national goal of trying to make one nation out of the Korean Peninsula. And for that to happen, we understand that we need alliance with the United States, that's vital. We also need to develop strategic communications with China. So this isn't a matter of choice for Korea, this is a matter of something we have to do. Now, I'm becoming a little more optimistic this week rather than, say, a couple of weeks ago, having seen Prime Minister Abe visiting China. I mean, China and Japan actually has been in fierce competition since 2012. And it's not good for Korea. US and China is fierce competition over South China Sea for several years. It's not good for Korea. But I think there is a side to great power competition that doesn't really meet the public eye very easily. That is, the great powers, big powers actually, are in competition, but at the same time always seek opportunities for some kind of rapprochement or some kind of a tentative agreement and understanding. And that is why I think Japanese Prime Minister visited China, and Japan is inviting Prime Minister Modi, and all around this diplomacy is going on. So I'm optimistic that these powers will probably rock the boat completely. So we'll see. But I think it's good for, and in the interest of Australia and my country as well, it's good for the peace, stability, and freedom of navigation in the chunks of sea that we all believe important.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, two things. Firstly, you can blame me personally for losing six more minutes of your morning tea. But secondly, can we thank our panel for a fascinating view of the Indo-Pacific?